afternoon, everyone. My name is Laura Mullen, and on behalf of ACRL and Choice, I'd like to welcome you to today's program, Text and Data Mining Library Content, sponsored by ProQuest and featuring Douglas Duhame. Today's discussion is one in a series of sponsored webinars from ACRL and Choice that addresses new ideas, developments, and products of interest to the academic library community. Free to users, these structured 60-minute live presentations provide the opportunity for discussions of important new issues and developments in academic librarianship by vendors, authors, librarians, and other interested stakeholders. Before we get started, I'd like to point out a few features of the webinar software. In the main area of the screen, you can follow along with the presentation materials. Along the left-hand side, you will see a chat panel that you can use to submit questions or comments. We'll spend some time responding to your questions during the program, so please feel free to submit these throughout. You'll also see a separate box for technical questions. Please feel free to use this feature for any technical difficulties you may be experiencing so our production team can troubleshoot them privately. And finally, please note that today's program will be recorded and all registrants will receive follow-up instructions on accessing the archived version. Our featured speaker today is Douglas Duhame. Doug studies 18th century British fiction, the history of science, and computational approaches to literary history. A recipient of the James A. Sappenfield Fellowship and the Frederick J. Huffman Award, he recently participated in the NEH-sponsored Early Modern Digital Agendas, a research summit on computational approaches to early modern English literature and history. At Notre Dame, he has taught courses with the Writing and Rhetoric Department and has served as assistant editor for Early American Literature. Mr. Duhame is currently the product manager for text and data mining at ProQuest. We also have Mary Beth Perot, Senior Marketing Manager at ProQuest, joining us today. She'll facilitate the Q&A session at the end of the presentation and help address any questions. At this point, I think we're ready to get started. So over to you, Doug.
Okay, thanks so much. So hopefully you can see on your screen here the results of some preliminary polling questions that we're conducting presently. And I can see that the majority of the audience self-identifies as a beginner in text and data mining. It looks like there's either a moderate amount and increasing amount of data mining interest on your campus, or there's also quite a bit of uncertainty. And then for the final question, it looks like we're pretty even split between universities at which there have been requests for text and data mining and universities for which there have not been requests. Hello all, I think we're back. It wouldn't be a text and data mining talk if there weren't a technological difficulty encountered during the talk. We had some bandwidth issues. Hopefully, we are all cleared up now. I just reviewed the preliminary results of the polling question we have displayed here, and we saw that the majority of you self-identify as beginners in text and data mining. Many of you have seen interest in text and data mining on your campuses and are identifying either, you know, a moderate amount or increasing amount of interest in this field. So I'm happy to clear these away and begin right in with the presentation here. Okay, excellent. So again, I'm Douglas Duhane, Text and Data Mining Product Manager here at ProQuest. And in today's talk, I'm going to give a brief introduction to the current landscape of text and data mining. I'm also going to talk a little bit about some of the key publication venues in which those who are interested in this field can find research papers and additional research topics. And then I'm going to focus primarily on looking at some of the key methods that are being used in text and data mining. And my goal throughout will be to give you an introduction to the field and really a conceptual orientation so that if you want to leave this talk and actually implement some data mining methods or maybe some new methods you haven't tried yet, you'll be able to do so fairly quickly. So with that as the frame, I'm going to dive in to talk about one of the motivations for this talk, which is the growth of the digital humanities in recent years. So many of you may be familiar with the field of digital humanities. In a nutshell, the digital humanities could be defined as the field of research in which scholars are applying digital and computational or algorithmic methods in order to study humanistic questions. So by using the Google Books N-gram viewer, as we see here, we can query for the phrase digital humanities, and we can visualize the frequency with which that term appears in books in recent years. So we can see a rapid rise of discussions surrounding digital humanities up through the beginning of the 21st century. If we want to look more recently, we can run a query on the ProQuest platform, and we can see in the lower right-hand corner that there's been a steady increase in publications that also mention digital humanities right up through 2015. So clearly, this computational approach to humanistic inquiry has been steadily increasing, which is one of the central motivations for today's talk. Next, I want to talk a bit about some of the key publication venues. And the idea here is if you find some of the methods or projects I'm going to discuss in this talk interesting, you'll be able to follow up within some of these venues and find, again, additional papers that may be of interest. And I've picked out four publication venues that are really driving this space here. In the upper left-hand corner, we have LLC, Literary and Linguistic Computing. In the upper right, DHQ, Digital Humanities Quarterly. And the bottom row, we have Digital Studies and the Journal of Digital Humanities. And as I look to Digital Studies, I see in the chat box there's still some audio issues. I hope others will be able to connect to the audio in short order. Okay. Thanks, Allison. Okay. Next, I'm going to dive into the real meat and potatoes of this talk, the key research methods. And during this portion of the talk, again, my goal is to give you a conceptual introduction to some of the leading methodological fields within DH and quantitative social sciences so that you'll be able to help implement some of these methods in your own research or in the research of others if you're working as a librarian. So here we have visualized some of the recent methodological trends in the digital humanities. This is a nice visualization put together by Scott Weingart, the digital humanities specialist at Carnegie Mellon University. And what he's done is he's taken the metadata tags associated with all submissions to the largest Digital Humanities annual conference for the last few years, from DH 2013, 14, and 15. And he's counted up the number of times each of these tags has occurred across those years so that he can identify which methodological fields or areas of inquiry have been rising in prominence and which have been sort of losing ground to other methods. I show this to illustrate the breadth of methodological inquiry going on in DH, and to point out that we're just going to be looking at a small subset of these methods in what follows, namely text analysis, natural language processing, and network mining. Those are three of the blue bars which have been gaining ground in recent years. Okay, so let's dive right in to the first of three methods. For each method, I'm going to discuss the goals of the method, some software packages that are commonly used to implement the method, and then I'm actually going to walk through the way you can implement this in your own research, or you can help others implement it in their own research. So the first methodological field on which I want to focus is machine learning. And the goal of machine learning is to use computational methods to, one, classify whether a given object possesses a particular property, number two, to cluster similar objects together, or three, to perform dimension reduction on one or more large matrices. And two of the more commonly used software packages in this space are Weka, which is a Java package with a very nice graphical user interface, and scikit-learn, which is a Python package scripting. Okay, so I want to give a conceptual introduction to the idea of clustering. And I'm going to do so by way of what is a fairly simple example, classifying basketball players. So the task here is to identify whether a person is or is not a basketball player. Okay, to do so, we can take 100 people, roughly half of whom are basketball players, and half of whom are not basketball players. The basketball players are blue here, the non-basketball players are red. For each of those 100 people, we want to measure their height and their weight. And then we're going to plot their position on this field. Okay, so I'll single out a sample point here. Hello all. We are still having technical difficulties, and so are transitioning to a new audio platform, namely the cellular phone. Just stand by, please.
Go ahead and keep talking, and I'll just switch.
Okay. Okay, while that's connecting, I'll carry us on. Sorry for the difficulties. Again, we're trying to classify basketball players. We have 100 of them, roughly half of whom, we have 100 people, half of whom are basketball players, half of whom are not basketball players. We've measured their height and their weight, and then we've plotted them. And in the case of this person right here, we see they have quite a bit of height and weight, and they are a basketball player, and are hence colored blue. I'm going to transition to the cell phone. Okay, hopefully. Okay, hopefully. Will be a bit of a clearer signal. And we'll carry on. Okay. Okay, I'm seeing in the chat box that everyone agrees universally that this is the better signal. I'm glad to see that. Excellent. So, in case you lost part of the last transmission, we have a sample task before us, which is to classify whether people are basketball players or not. In order to pursue this task, we've taken 100 people, roughly half of whom are basketball players, half of whom are not basketball players. In each case, we're going to measure their height and their weight, and then we're going to plot their position within this field. And you can see I have a little green arrow here, and I've singled out one particular person who happens to be a basketball player, and we've plotted their height, their weight, and we've color-coded their point in order to indicate that they are a basketball player. So we do this for all of our 100 people. We know that these people are either basketball players or not basketball players. The catch is that there will be future people, and we will wish to classify whether they are basketball players or non-basketball players, given this, quote, training data. To do so, we want to color each pixel on this field either red or blue. And this is the interesting bit right here. To color a pixel, I'll single out a pixel right here. The procedure is to find the three points that are closest to that pixel. So in the case of the present pixel, we have one point over here, one point over here, and one point over here. Okay, if the majority of those points are basketball players, then we're going to color the pixel blue. If the majority of those people are not basketball players, we'll color the pixel red. So for instance, if we chose this pixel, the three nearest people rather, might be 1, 2, 3. And because the majority of those people are not basketball players, we color the pixel red. So we perform this operation for every single picture in the field. And by doing so, we can color code each pixel as being either red or blue. Then, when another person, for whom we don't know whether they're a basketball player or not a basketball player, when another person walks into our office, we take their height and their weight, and we measure those values, and then we plot them in this space. If they land in a red space, then we classify them as not a basketball player. If they land in a blue space, we classify them as a basketball player. This is just one sort of implementation of what's called k-nearest neighbors classification. Okay, I'm seeing in the chat, I'm very glad to have the chat because I can respond in real time. There's confusion over the axes. Typically, axes in machine learning will be scaled from 0 to 1 for each axis. And to do that, you can just divide each value by the maximum value. So for instance, in basketball, I looked up the fact that the tallest basketball player on record is evidently Manute Bol, who's 7'7", and that computes to 91 inches. If we measured our tallest basketball player here, say this is Manute Bol, and they're 91 inches, we can divide each person's height by that maximum value, by 91 in this case. So we take Manute Bol, our value here, who has 91 inches, we divide by 91, and we get 1. That'll be at the top of the frame. And for people who are shorter, they'll be somewhere between 0 and 1. This is referred to as centering one's features in machine learning. Okay, hopefully that made sense. So that's a quick introduction to k-nearest neighbors classification. And now we're going to move on to talking about how one can use this k-nearest neighbors in the case of text analysis. So here we have a very similar plot, but in this case we're going to be classifying the sentiment of sentences. So I'm going to walk you through the steps that we can use in order to classify the sentiment of sentences. Okay, the first step will be to create a list of positive words. So we have a list, A+, acclaim, accolade, all the way to zippy. Likewise, we're going to create a list of negative words. abominable, abrasive, abusive, zombie. I didn't make these lists up. These are actually open source lists. Okay. Then, once we have our positive and negative lists, we're going to select a sentence to analyze. And to keep things simple, I've chosen a rather nice Beatles lyric, "All you need is love, all you need is love, all you need is love, love is all you need." Okay. We take that sentence and we're going to remove any words in the sentence that don't appear in the positives or the negative word list. So this reduces our sentence to a very repetitive sequence, four instances of love. Okay. Then we identify the percent of remaining words that are positive and negative, and we plot our point. Now, if we've proceeded in the same way as we did with the basketball players, where we've color-coded pixels based on some training data, we can say that if the point falls in blue territory, the sentiment of our sentence is positive, whereas if it falls in the negative territory, the sentiment is negative. So this is a fairly straightforward implementation of sentiment classification, but it turns out to be one of the engines behind even reading digital humanist research, such as the work of Matthew Jockers. Some of you may be familiar with the fact that Matthew Jockers, professor at Nebraska, has been studying sentiment trajectories in literary texts. So here we have plotted the sentiment trajectory for James Joyce's novel Portrait of the Artist. The x-axis in this plot is time over the course of Portrait of the Artist, and the y-axis indicates how positive or negative the sentiment of that portion of the text is. So at the very beginning of the text, all the way to the left on the x-axis, we see baby Tucko. Things are very happy and positive. The text begins, "Once upon a time, and a very good time it was, da-da-da-da-da-da." Very high positive sentiment. Then young Stephen Dedalus goes off to school, and the sentiment rapidly drops off. Things really start going downhill fast. He's shoved in the ditch by some of his mates, and things become worse still. Eventually, though, he meets Father Arnell, and things start to pick up, and so on and so forth. So using even just these simple positive and negative word lookups, one can produce a sentiment trajectory, just as Professor Jockers has done very nicely here. With a slightly different implementation, if one classifies not the sentiment of a sentence, but whether or not particular language is economic or financial in nature, one can replicate the work produced by Ted Underwood, Hoyt Long, and Richard Jean So. This is the same kind of machine classification. They've taken texts and they've classified whether words in those texts refer to economic or financial entities. And you can see here the x-axis is the long 19th century, and the y-axis is the number of references to amounts of money per 10,000 words. And we can see a pretty steady ascent or increase in the amount of discussion of economic topics over the course of the long 19th century, showing very much a rising concern with the nature of economic activity. And we can also see the ways some texts deviate from that trend. So I'll call attention to Fitzgerald's The Great Gatsby, the text we sort of associate with financial activity. Gatsby is this, mogul who was able to command all of this money. But those who have read the text know that economic matters are very much concealed in the text. And we can visualize that. The text departs from the norm of its time very easily with this graphic. Okay, so that's machine classification. The next methodological field I want to discuss is plagiarism detection, or the detection of textual reuse. And the goal here is to identify textual reuse or plagiarized content in significant historical and cultural works. And two of the software packages that are often used for this purpose are the PEAR project, produced by the Artful team at the University of Chicago, which was originally written in Perl. It's actually since been piped into Python. And the difflib package in Python is also very good for this purpose. And again, I'm going to introduce a sample application. In this case, the research task is to detect cross-lingual plagiarisms in historical texts. I chose a cross-lingual text or example because I wanted to keep things interesting. So on the left here, we have a sample sentence from Voltaire's Essay on Wit, published in 1748. And on the right, we have a selection from Oliver Goldsmith's periodical, The Bee, published over 10 years later. And if you read French, you can see that Goldsmith has just taken the words out of Voltaire's mouth. He's translated them into English. And it turns out to be the case that if we look at Goldsmith's corpus more broadly, he stole plenty of content from French writers. Okay, so now I'm going to walk us through how we can detect textual reuse in this case. So here's the sample workflow. We start by selecting the texts that we wish to analyze, and here we have them pictured on the right. Okay. The next step will be to translate all of the texts into a common language and lowercase them. I'll mention that there are lots of translation models that are sort of trained on English translation. That is, they translate very well into English. So English is a good language into which to translate everything. So here we go. We translate everything into English and we lowercase everything. Then we have a number of very common words, words that appear frequently, like articles and prepositions, and these are commonly called stop words. We want to remove those stop words and the punctuation. And you see them highlighted in green, and whoop, now they're gone. Okay. You can see that after each of these translations of the text, each of these sort of deformations of the text, they become more and more similar. Next, what we can do is to reduce all words to their linguistic stems. So, for instance, Goldsmith has the word falling, whereas Voltaire had, well, when we translate it to English, fall. Goldsmith had splitting, Voltaire has split, Goldsmith has dissolving, Voltaire has dissolve. In order to get those words to map onto one another, we can reduce all words to their stems, and when we perform this operation, we see that splitting became split, falling became fall. And now we have even more similarity between Voltaire and Oliver Goldsmith. Okay. Next, we can measure the percentage of words that are shared in common between our two sentences. So if we look at the Voltaire text, we have 17 words, 13 of which occur in the Goldsmith passage. Or 76% of which occur in the Goldsmith passage. And then we can use this measure as the probability that this sentence pair contains text reuse. So using these simple operations, we can say there's a 76% probability that the Goldsmith text is an instance of textual reuse from the Voltaire. Okay. So a few sample projects. I mentioned before the Artful team out of the University of Chicago, led very much by Mark Olson and Glenn Rowe. They've been focusing on identifying plagiarisms and textual reuse within French language documents. And in particular, they've been researching the encyclopédie and researching the ways that crowning achievement of the French Enlightenment borrowed texts from earlier encyclopedias. Another interesting text reuse project is the Tesserae project at the University of Buffalo. And they've actually been studying textual reuse in classical language documents, so documents written in Latin and in Greek. And they have a very nice interface if you visit their website. It's very easy to study textual reuse within those documents. Okay. The third and final method on which I want to focus today is network analysis. And the goal of network analysis is to leverage quantitative methods in order to analyze the relationships between linked entities, or to study relationships between a certain class of objects, essentially. And two of the more commonly used software packages for this kind of analysis are Gephi, which has brilliant visualization implementations within it, and Network X, which is a more sort of scripting-friendly implementation of network analysis in Python. So network analysis is a huge field, and we're just going to skim very briefly over the surface, but the key concepts are that networks are composed of nodes, which are really the entities, the things that we're studying. Nodes could be anything. They could be literary characters. They could be individuals at a university. They could be your Facebook friends. And those nodes are connected by edges. Edges are the things that connect the different nodes here. And edge weights are an indication of how prevalent or strong or pronounced the connection between two nodes is. And this becomes much simpler with a quick example. So we have a sample application here, which is to visualize character networks in Shakespearean drama. So here I've chosen King Henry V. Here's a little network plot of King Henry V, and we can see, let's point him out here. Oh, where's my arrow? Here she comes. Okay, here's King Henry V over here, and over here we have the French court, and over here we have the English court. In this visualization, each node is a character in Henry V, and the edges indicate that those characters appear on stage together within Henry V. And I'm going to walk us through one way in which we can produce this kind of plot. So the first step, as always, is to find a research corpus or to select a text to analyze. Here we're going to focus on King Henry V, by William Shakespeare, remembered for its St. Crispin's Day speech, one of my favorites. Okay, the next step is to select the nodes and the edges we wish to study in the course of this analysis. So here we're going to study characters as the nodes, and edges we're going to set to character co-occurrence. So each character gets a node, and if two characters appear on stage together, we're going to create edges between those characters. Okay. The next step will be to split the input text into a series of scenes. So we have a little list here from the first scene to the final scene of Henry V. Okay. For each of those scenes, we will next list the characters that occur in the scene. So in Act 1, Scene 1, we have the Archbishop of Canterbury, Hughie, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Then, each time two characters appear in the same scene, we're going to increase the edge weight between them by one. So, the first time Tistel and Gower occur together in the same scene, we're going to set their edge weight to one. If they co-occur together within a scene later on in the text, we're going to increment their edge weight by one. And in this way, at the end, the edge weight between two characters will indicate the total number of times they appear on stage together at the same time. Finally, we can plot all nodes and all edges that have a weight greater than n in this case. You can see there's no real edge weight indicated here. Edges are really just binary indicators of the fact that two nodes have an edge weight greater than some threshold n. Here n is 2. One could choose a higher threshold or a lower threshold. Okay. So some sample network analysis research applications. Some of the developers here at ProQuest have been studying just what I was showing you, character co-occurrence within dramatic texts. It happens to be the case that ProQuest has wonderful literary collections, the vast majority of which are double hand keyed, such as the Lion texts, almost 500,000 documents, double hand keyed, and they have great markup, so we can see clean representations of characters' names, and we can easily produce network plots of those characters in dramatic texts over time. One of my other favorite projects is the 6 Degrees of Francis Bacon project, at least one member of which is with us today. Hi, Jessica. And the 6 Degrees of Francis Bacon project is essentially a research environment in which scholars can study the networks that connected early modern agents. It's an attempt to answer the question, if Sir Francis Bacon had a Facebook account, what would it look like? What would his friend's Facebook networks look like? Okay. Here's zooming in a little bit on the 6 degrees of Francis Bacon project. We can see William Laud, who was an English churchman and a religious advisor to King Charles I. He persecuted some Puritans and paid for it with his life. And we can see Laud's connections to many other early modern figures, including Charles I, the large green node towards the top of the screen. Okay, and then finally, we have the Kindred Britain project out of Stanford University. And this is also a network visualization environment in which one can study lots of individuals from British history, and one can engage with the network in lots of different interesting ways. So one can, for instance, color code nodes based on their centrality or their importance within the network. Or one can color code nodes, as in here, by their gender. So each person who's a female gets a purple color, and males get a blue color. Or if one is studying English monarchical history, one can color code, various monarchical figures by their degree of inbreeding, a very unique feature to this data set. All right, so that's a quick introduction to the text and data mining sphere within the digital humanities. Again, I've tried to cover a brief introduction to the field, give you a sense of where some of the scholarship in this space can be found in publications, as well as a brief conceptual introduction to some of the more commonly used methods in the field and some of the sample projects that have been produced using those methods. And at this point, I want to turn things over really to you and open up a conversation on text and data mining. I'm happy to answer questions that have cropped up in the course of this talk, or additional questions that you might have about text and data mining. Okay. With that, Mary Beth?
Hi. Okay, Doug. Thank you very much. That was very informative, and glad that we worked through the technical issues.
Yeah,
there are a couple of questions, and I'm going to refer back to some of the methods. So there are a couple related to the machine learning method and when you were detecting keywords, the positive and negative keywords. So are you able to detect irony or sarcasm as well? I think it's one that came up.
In fact, there are papers on irony and sarcasm detection. If one gets into looking at some of the literature on natural language processing, there are certainly papers in the field. It's a very difficult task. I haven't seen great accuracy in classifiers that were working in that space, but there is active research, and I'd encourage you, you'd really want to look at some of the ACL publications and some of the more technical natural language processing publications to pursue irony.
Okay. Okay, and then another one that came up related to that is, how does it cope with, were these generated by Weka or scikit-learn?
These plots were generated by, the classification was produced by scikit-learn, and the plots were also produced within Python. I could share code as well if individuals would like to email me. I think I'm allowed to do that.
Cool. Thank you very much. And sure. We're heading over. There's a couple that came through while you were talking about detecting plagiarism, and I love the detecting French versus English. So there was a question that came up. How does it cope with heteronyms and homonyms?
Sure. Heteronyms. In fact, I need to look up the definition of the word heteronyms. homonyms, I'm not sure how they would come into play here. I think that's sort of an orthogonal question, but if the question is really how can we engage in fuzzier semantic analysis so that we can catch not even exact duplication of language, but some slight deviations from the representations of ideas. So if Voltaire is using a certain form of expression to represent an idea, and Goldsmith uses none of the same words, we can get into comparing vector distances. So one of the simplest techniques, I'll say, is to transpose all of your words into a vector space. And there are great packages for doing this. I would highly recommend folks look at Stanford's GLOVE package, G-L-O-V-E, or Google's Word2Vec package, either of which can be used to essentially transpose a large collection of documents. They can be used to transpose each word within those documents into a vector space, a high-dimensional vector space, and then one can cluster the vectors in order to identify fuzzier instances of textual reuse. And I have some code to that end actually on my website.
Okay. And does that also take into account word proximity?
Yes. So typically scholars will track proximity of, let's say two utterances in a few different ways. So one of the methods I myself have been using is to use the sentence as the fundamental unit of analysis. So if we know that sentence A and sentence B have a certain similarity, then we can say, you know, there's great similarity within these localized linguistic units. This sentence is a unit of localization here. Other people create sliding windows. So if we have a text that's, 100 words long, we can create a window that's 10 words long. And at the beginning, we look at the first 10 words of our text, and then we slide the window forward, let's say, one word. So now we're looking at words 2 through 11, and so on and so forth. We continue sliding the windows, and then we compare textual similarity for each window. That's another technique to maintain proximity.
Okay, cool. And will the two products be in the session transcript? We couldn't understand the name. So you had mentioned Google and GLOVE, I think you said, from Stanford?
Yes. I think I can type. There we go. David Beals has provided a link to the GLOVE package. And then Word2Vec is the other. There it is.
Perfect.
Thank you so much.
Word2Vec. And there it is. It's part of the transcript. Okay, on to more questions. What languages do, and I'm not sure I'm pronouncing this right, GEPI and Network X use?
GEPI is primarily Java-based, and Network X is a Python library that likely has some C++ dependencies, but you'd call it from Python.
Okay, thank you. And we have a couple of questions here. Would you mind returning to the publishing outlet slide? And I'm not sure which one that was.
Oh, I'm thinking it was. Are we going back to the publications or to the publication output as visualized on the ProQuest platform?
Charlotte, send a note in chat and let us know. And as we're doing that, we do have a question on how can you mine ProQuest newspapers?
perfect question. So some of you may know that ProQuest has recently launched a data delivery service through which researchers can access enormous quantities of historical newspaper content. The long and the short is that if you're interested in this service, please feel free to write me at doug.duhaime, D-U-H-A-I-M-E, at ProQuest, and I'll be happy to walk through the procedure with you. But in a nutshell, we had arranged things such that you would get emailed a hyperlink that would lead you to a space in Amazon Web Services from which you could crawl millions of historical newspaper documents, pull them down onto your local servers, and then perform whatever kind of data mining you're interested in on those documents. It's a fully automated system, and it's really amazing. It's one of the largest text collections for which you can gain full text access that I'm aware of, at least. And I think it's a great resource. I very much encourage you, if you're interested in obtaining large data collections, to send me a note, and we can talk about gaining you access to historical newspaper content.
Cool, thank you. And Charlotte says this is indeed the slide that she wanted to see. A couple more questions here. What are the problems that people are working on solving within the specific methods discussed today? So within these methods, if you have other examples.
Well, so because these are all quantitative methods, one can measure accuracy of one's output, the accuracy of one's classification decision, for instance, or the precision and recall of one's textual reuse detection algorithms, and so on and so forth. So one of the chief tasks, maybe the chief task in this kind of research, is improving that accuracy rate. So finding more clever features that can be used to train models in order to improve accuracy of the model. So for instance, when we discussed classifying basketball players, we looked at just two sample features. We'd call them height and weight. If one really wanted to classify basketball players very accurately, one would produce additional features that could be used to classify these individuals. So we might, for instance, study or we might include in our model the number of basketball trophies achieved by the person under analysis. That might be an important feature in our model. And by adding additional features and doing very clever things with the actual machine learning implementation, one can raise the accuracy of the classifier. So that's a huge task in NLP and in data mining more broadly. But there are lots and lots of tasks. I think finding appropriate data sets is one of the largest tasks that I've struggled with, and I've seen others struggle with. It can be very difficult to find clean representations of historical text documents, and so those are very valuable if one can't find them. There are really many difficulties. Those are two chief difficulties among them.
Okay, thanks, Doug. I've seen a few questions come in here about if one wants to get started with text mining, what types of can we analyze text from a journal, a group of journals that you own from ProQuest? How would you go about doing that? And I'll go ahead and answer that question very briefly. There's yes, you have, as Doug mentioned, we do have the data delivery service for some of our historical, all of our historical newspapers, but historical collections as well. So you'll see at the top left, you have an evaluation, a link to an evaluation. So when we complete this webinar, please go ahead and it's, I think, a 3 or 4 question survey that we can provide you with additional information after the webinar. There are a couple other questions here, Doug, that I wanted to have you address. Are there examples of linking based upon often hidden semantic meanings?
Linking. This is interesting because in normal, conference situations, it's easy to follow up with a quick question for clarification.
Yeah.
But in this case, that's a little more difficult. I'm not exactly sure what linking would mean in this instance. Is it possible to clarify in chat?
Sure. And David, if you could, that would be great, and we'll keep an eye out for that.
Mm-hmm.
Are most of these tools and platforms platforms open source, or are there any that are proprietary? Can you give a little bit more detail on that?
Sure. I believe all of the packages and software environments I'll discuss today are open source. I'm a big proponent of open source software, they can be easily downloaded. I will say, beware if you're working on a Windows machine, it can be a little difficult. It'd be very nice if you could access a Linux-based environment that will make your life a lot easier in some cases. But there are no licensing restrictions that would prevent you from accessing the software packages and implementations.
Great, thank you. And could you provide the source of the chart on trending methods within digital humanities? So I think that chart was right at the beginning.
Oh, sure. So that's actually from Scott Weingart's blog. It would take me a moment to hustle up the link. But this is his review of DH 2015. If someone else might be able to fish out a link to that, or Scott's out there somewhere, that would be very helpful. He had a three-part blog series on DH 2015, and this plot came from one of those posts.
Okay. Thanks. So you said it was Scott. Oh, there we go. Thank you, Robert. Scottbot.net. So thanks, Robert, for that. Okay, in network analysis, why do they call them edges?
Well, that's a fine question. I guess that's a historical question, of which I'm not sure the answer. We can, edges. You know, I'm not sure the historical reason they were called edges, but that's become convention. Edge is that which connects nodes.
Okay, if anybody out there, it's Jessica, thank you. It's standard graph terminology among mathematicians.
Yeah, but why? Why edge? And, like, it could have been any term, you know? It's really an etymological question. It's a historical question. Yes.
Okay, and then we have several here, thank you. It sounds like many of us would like to know if ProQuest content can be text mined. There is content available for data delivery where researchers or faculty could use it for text and data mining purposes, and that does vary. Mostly it is historical information, and certainly the historical newspapers are available, and there are the years of coverage vary, so on each one of those 45 historical newspapers. Those are the ones that are available via cloud access. Any of the other content delivery is done a bit more manually, so it's delivered on hard disk drives. So I think there were a few questions related to the newspapers, current versus historical. On some of them, again, the historical newspapers. An example of, you know, the black newspapers, there's a couple that have coverage through 2003. So there is 20th century coverage in some of those titles. Okay, and the range of cost for being able to download a given data set from ProQuest, that is, it depends on the content. It's done on a cost recovery basis simply for, you know, for manufacturing costs. So it's a nominal fee if you already own that content. So, and it ranges. There's a variety. So if you click on the evaluation, if you're interested in more information, we are happy to get in touch with you after the webinar and have your account manager get in touch with you as well. Okay, another question came in, and I think we have about 5 minutes left here. In a sentiment progression analysis, like Jocker's graph of the the portrait of the artist, is the text analyzed as a whole with a percentage of total word count, or by chapter or by paragraph? Would one system of text division be better than others?
Well, that's a really interesting question. One of the big debates surrounding sentiment analysis is ground truth. So those who have followed the release of Matt Jacker's R package yet saw that essentially Professor Jacker's released a package written in R that allows researchers to study these sentiment trajectories over novels. And it was greeted with great interest and a bit of suspicion. There was quite some debate in it amongst digital humanists as to the implementation used, whether or not it was proper, whether we could do better. I would say that one of the more interesting contributions to the debate came from David Bannon, who's recently finished his PhD and is actually headed over to Berkeley, I believe. David is a phenomenal researcher. He was looking at hand-labeled sentiment analysis of Shakespearean texts. I believe it was Romeo and Juliet. And so what he had done is to set up a mechanical Turk account and have a number of annotators basically hand-mark the sentiment of a text and identify how positive or negative they thought a particular region of the text is. The region could be, it could be a sentence, it could be, you know, a whole scene. I'd have to look back and see what he had actually used. But given that hand-labeled data, one can then evaluate how well a machine implementation matches the hand-annotated data. So, in order to answer the question, what is the appropriate unit of analysis, one really needs to think again with some hand-labeled data, some ground truth values that one wants one's predictive model to match. Given a unit of analysis for the hand training data, that is the hand user annotated data, data annotated by actual humans, given that unit of analysis, one would use the same in machine implementation, presumably, and continue iterating over parameters until one found the parameter suite that allowed the model to correctly classify the sentiment of a text.
Okay, and it looks like, did you say David Bannon? Is that the correct spelling?
So Bannon. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. And I think we're just a minute or two away. I do see one more to get more information on ProQuest data delivery. I would say send an email to Doug at doug.duhaime, that's D-U-H-A-I-M-E, at ProQuest.com. And you'll certainly have that information here as well when you have a link to this archived webinar. So if there are no other questions, I'm going to go ahead and turn this back over to Laura, since we are close to closing time here. Thank you, Doug.
Thanks so much. Thanks for attending, all.
Great. And thanks to you both, Mary Beth and Doug. That was a great presentation. I'd like to give you both a virtual round of applause and also thank all of our participants for joining us today. As a reminder, we have recorded today's program, so be on the lookout for a follow-up email from ACRL and Choice that will include instructions on accessing the archived version. Thanks again to all of our participants for joining us. We hope you enjoyed today's session. Please have a great rest of your day.